days we took a ride through hell but stayed intact. Back in the days we did before we thought and came out new. Back in the days we got busted, we got caught and we slipped through. Like water slowly carving stone, somehow time shaped these bodies of our own. We're better now. We changed somehow. We're better now. Back in the days, we swayed and lost control and went down well. Back in the days, we lost our heart and soul so we'd excel. Back in the days, we were lied to, we were played to learn what's fake. Back in the days, we bent and did not break, we did not break. Like water slowly carving stone, we change somehow. Time shaped these bodies of our own. We're better now. We change somehow. We're better now.
Ricky Miller. Enabling wildlife conservation.
About giving up and didn't know what to do. do. Then it was you. And everything went from wrong to right. All the stars came out and filled the night. Music they were playing really blew my mind. It was love at first. It was love at first sight.
Me. blood in my body, from my head to my toes. There's people all around me, gearing up for the show. I can feel it in my body, from my head to my toes. There's people all around me, but I'm here with you.
Artificial intelligence isn't coming, it's here. It's the defining technology of our time. But it's human ingenuity that makes it so powerful. Jane started losing her vision when she was 12.
California Street.
She uses seeing AI.
I crept down the stairs and out the door.
Which enables her to read and navigate her world. Microsoft AI is helping farmers adapt to climate change.
We can use technology to help feed the world without wrecking the planet.
Enabling wildlife conservation.
The ability to use AI really democratizes science. WildMe uses images from any source to help study endangered species.
And creating new ways for people with hearing loss to communicate.
I want the exact same information that my hearing friends have.
It's more than just imitating intelligence or sounding like a human. Microsoft AI is changing every industry, from healthcare.
And now you can see these finite details, the relationship with many structures.
To engineering. And telecommunications.
We are using artificial intelligence to change the way we are relating to customers.
AI lets us put people first.
The Microsoft tools really enabled us to breathe digital life into an iconic brand persona.
The product that we make is not a thing in a box.
No.
Microsoft AI empowers others to create experiences and potential. This is just the beginning.
Artificial intelligence, it's just opened up this whole world.
The future we invent is a choice we make.
Well, there you have it, folks. That is artificial intelligence for you. Please note that artificial intelligence is not here to replace humans, and they're not robots that are going to take over the world. Well, we have Narcisse here to show us AI as the tool for tomorrow. Narcisse, please come through and show us how to actually use AI in our everyday lives. Yeah, I can. Narcisse, sorry to cut you off. I think they lost the audio. Yeah, they can't.
Okay. What about now? Can they hear me?
Yes, they can.
Okay, cool. I'm glad to hear that. Once again, welcome, everybody. Thanks, Somaleze, for the intro. I guess we can start with today's session, AI, the tool for tomorrow. We'll start right now. Start. Okay, can you see, is my screen visible?
Yes, it is.
Okay, cool. AI, the tool for tomorrow, and Assis Mbuyu. I want to introduce myself, but I'm a beta student ambassador, and I hope throughout the next series of shows, you'll get to know more about me as the show goes on, and I'll start. So, AI. What is AI? If we can read by what is written on the slideshow, it says artificial intelligence is the intelligence demonstrated by machines, is the intelligence that computers or our devices can show. So that is basically what artificial intelligence is, the capability or the intelligence shown by the machines. According to us as humans, we or animals, we have something called natural intelligence. This is what defines us. This is what determines our intelligence level. This is referred to as natural intelligence. But now, when we talk about artificial intelligence, we're not talking about man or an animal. We're talking now about machines. So that is artificial intelligence. As we go in more in depth about what is AI, we can say that AI is a makes use of intelligent agents that enables it to perceive the environment around it and makes it probable to obtaining information or a specific amount or to reach a specific goal. So artificial intelligence uses that intelligence that it has to bring in information or to achieve a specific goal or make certain probabilities. Another function of what AI can do, which is a really cool feature, is it can mimic cognitive services or cognitive functionalities that us humans or animals are able to do. So like talking, seeing, speaking and all that, AI can also mimic that. The reason why we say mimic, because it can't do exactly what we're doing as human, because it has artificial intelligence and not natural intelligence. But the cool thing about it is that it can mimic. Can you imagine that? So that's in a nutshell is what artificial intelligence is, an intelligence that is demonstrated by machines or devices. Yeah. So I hope that that is basically a small introduction about what is AI. So from time to time, this is just an introduction. So there's going to be a lot of theory, I have to say, but I'll take away some boredom by playing some small videos here and there. And then at the end of the session, I'll hope to do some small practicals to get people excited about AI and what we'll be doing for the coming weeks. So as I said, this is just an introduction. So all the theory that we're learning right now, we'll be slowly putting it into practice in the next coming episodes on AI Tuesday. So we'll continue. So what is AI made up of? As we can see, AI is made up of four key elements, namely machine learning, anomaly detection, computer vision, natural language processing, and conversational AI. So a bit about what I've just mentioned. Machine learning, as the name entails, is basically the capability of the machine to take in information, to learn and interpret what is made sense around it. So that's what is machine learning, the capability or the ability of a machine or a device or whatever program, can even be a program, for it to learn. That is what machine learning is. As if to make it more direct, it's a foundation for the AI system that in uh, and This is a foundation for the AI system and is the way we teach computer models to make a prediction and draw conclusions from data. I hope you can see the key points over there. To teach a computer model to make prediction and draw conclusions from data. So basically, machine learning is that as us human beings, although we have natural getting some feedback from my technical team. Is my screen blurry from your side?
Yes, it is, but I'm not entirely sure whether it's the network or it's a problem on your side.
I think it's on my side. Let me try zooming in. That's too much. Let's try again, zooming in slowly. Bit more. I think it's my resolution, the way I set it up. Is that better now? Okay, looks to be better.
When you zoom in, it looks a bit better, a bit clearer than when you zoom out.
Okay, no problem. The viewers are saying that it's much better, so I will take it as that. But just let me know what the viewers are saying as they're following through. Thank you, viewers, for your feedback. Your feedback is highly appreciated. As we continue, as I was saying that, as we read, it teaches a computer model to make a prediction and draw conclusions from data. As I was saying that, as us human beings or animals, we have something. Okay, still with the feedback, I'm just gonna try and fix this blurry screen. Just try and make more sense of it. Give me a minute. Sorry for the interruptions. Please let me know, viewers, if that's much better for you guys to see properly. If it's much better.
Apparently, it looks good now.
Okay, no problem. No problem. Thank you for the feedback. As I was saying, as us human beings, we have something called natural intelligence. We are limited with our natural intelligence. We are limited. So artificial intelligence offers machine learning as a capability to extend our limitations. So whatever we can do as humans with our natural intelligence, like we can't read data as fast, we can't comprehend data as fast. With machine learning, it can do it at a greater scale. So that's one of the capabilities of machine learning. It enables us to do things that we can't do, but a machine is able to do it to help us, if you get what I mean. As I reiterate, to teach a computer model to make a prediction and draw conclusions from data. That is the most important part. The next point, anomaly detection. Anomaly detection has to do with mistakes. So as I said, we are limited as human beings. We cannot pick up mistakes easily. We are often blinded or fooled by or deceived by certain concepts, but a machine is not. A machine cannot be deceived or fooled by small errors. In fact, it's 99.9% accurate and correct. You know, whilst us human beings, we're looking at 85% to 70% accuracy to try and detect mistakes and anomalies. So with using artificial intelligence, it can do it for us. You see the difference between that 70 or 85% to that 99.9%. It increases the ability to detect errors in our work, in things that we do in our everyday life at a greater scale. as you read, the capability to automatically detect errors or unusual activities in a system, something that we can't do, but with artificial intelligence, it's helping us to do better. And as I mentioned earlier, the next point, computer vision. So with AI, it also enables us to mimic human functionalities. As I said, seeing, talking, and reading, all of those are what we have as humans, you know. And now we've given that capabilities to artificial intelligence, to machines, through computer vision. It's the capability of a software to interpret the world visually through cameras, videos, and images. So we have our eyes, our sensors, basically, but a machine doesn't have all of that. What instead it has is our cameras. It has cameras, it has microphones, it has sensors as well, and it also has videos and images. It's able to process all of that. So we make use of those that I've just mentioned to give it the capability to interpret and visualize the world around it. It's a really cool concept. So the same way I can read, the artificial intelligence or the machine can also do the same thing as I'm doing. And later on throughout the show, we're going to see how that works. The next point that I'm making is natural language processing. And this is a really cool feature that artificial intelligence has. So not everyone can read, not everyone can talk. We have disabilities, and that can be very depressing, or it can be very discouraging and really unfair to some people. But now, with the aid of artificial intelligence, with the use of natural language processing, we can bring that capabilities to people who don't have that. You know, it's like a second chance. And through natural language processing, we are giving the computer the capability to interpret written or spoken language and respond and to give a response back to what has been given. So it's like, if I'm not able to talk, I just use natural language processing, and I'll be able to talk back, not with my voice, but with the machine doing it for me, with the machine helping me out. So that's really a cool feature, and all these things I'm saying now is gonna be shown later on. The next point, conversational AI, the capability of a software to participate in the conversation. So now, I'm sure you guys, we all use this conversational AI every day when we go to certain websites like your HP, your Microsoft. All of these companies are making use of bots. You know, we have WhatsApp bots, we have all these bots, and these bots use conversational AI to create a conversation with you. So back then, beforehand, people used to literally go on the phones calling the customers, each customers day by day, to try and find out what's the problem, you know, customer service and all of that. And all of that is eradicated with the use of conversational AI. There's no more use for that. So basically, people are now starting to lose their jobs, if you look at it, because of this conversational AI. It's still in the implementation stage, but once it's perfected and made use of, think about how easy the future would be, you know. And that's the key element of what artificial intelligence is made up of. And now let's go more in depth on these things. As I said, machine learning is the ability of AI to get and interpret data, as you've mentioned. So as it's written there, as I mentioned, it's the foundation for the for AI, because it needs the data to interpret and make use of it. And then another thing that machine learning involves is that it uses statistics or data, right? So as it says there, it's a subset that uses statistical techniques to give computers the abilities to learn from their environment. That's another key important thing to note about machine learning. It uses data and statistics. So in order for it to learn, we have to feed the machine as much data as possible. as much stats as possible. If it doesn't have a lot of stats, if it doesn't have a lot of data, how can it learn? You know, it's like us growing up. In order for us to grow, we need to eat. We need to drink a lot of water. We need to keep on feeding ourselves constantly that in order for us to grow. Same thing with a machine. If you want a machine to learn, if you want your machine to grow as well, you need to keep on feeding it data and stats for it to grow and enable to learn and interpret the world, the environment around it. As it says, it enables computers to improve on a particular task without being specifically programmed for that task. So, for example, I want to detect a certain flower. In my garden. So, and I don't Google all the time on the internet. But what I can do instead, I can use a machine learning as I feed it a lot of samples of plants and flowers, I can feed it as much as possible so that when I don't know what plant is in my garden or I'm surrounded by a new plant, I can just take out my app or the application that I have, and it's able to read to me what type of plant it is because I fed it a lot of data. It has a knowledge of it and it's able to learn from it. I hope that it makes sense. Yes. So moving on to the next point. So I'll stop talking about big machine learning for a moment and focus on another crucial part, which is big data. I'm sure everyone has heard of this. So big data is simply a large amount of data. So basically a large amount of collection of data. So that's what big data is a large amount of data. And data comes from all places, from our technological devices like cell phones, our tablets, our kiosks, computers, registers, and all of those put together, they generate a large volume of data. If you think about it. So every single day of our life, when we use our devices, when we use our phones, when we use our computer, we're one way or another letting go of data. And this data that we're letting go of or we're letting go of or using, it's been taken by these companies so that they can learn and so that they can feed it to those to their machines so that they can learn our habits, what we tend to do on the internet or whatever device we're using and all of this. So all of these technologies that I've just mentioned make use of big data and machine learning. So that is the relationship between big data and its relationship with machine learning. A quick example of machine learning, we'll see it in action just now. Let's see, it's in action just now. Let me play it.
Right now, artificial intelligence.
Sorry about that.
Helps us meet the needs of today, so we're prepared for.
By 2050, we need to produce 60% more food. So how are we going to feed the world without wrecking the planet? Using Microsoft artificial intelligence, we can reduce waste and produce more food. Any grower will tell you every row, every crop is different. We can use Microsoft AI to make local predictions about light, wind, rain. This helps farmers know when to plant, irrigate, and harvest. It's making a difference.
Artificial intelligence helps farmers grow more while wasting less.
And there you go, folks. That is machine learning in action. As we just saw from that video, this company, The Yield, it makes use of machine learning to learn the help to learn the climate or the tendency of the climate in which they're living in. So looks at the rain conditions, the wind, and all of those things to make predictions in order to farm. So they're looking at the weather, the rain, if it's going to rain today, when it's going to rain, when it's going to be windy, what type of weather to expect, is it going to be sunny and stuff. And all of those information that I've just mentioned, they use it in order to grow plants, in order to grow crops, you know, as you've just saw in the video. So that's how machine learning works. So they look through the statistics or the data of all those weather formats. So they look at the weather forecasts of the previous dates. So for example, today is the 17th of February. So they looked at 17th of February for the past few years, 2019, all those days beforehand, and now they got information about the type of weather to expect. So they fed it to the AI, to the machine learning, and that machine learning is able to come up or predict what type of weather we will have next year, 2022, on the 16th of February, 17th of February. Yes, so that's like a clear example from the video as I'm elaborating more on it. Another example on machine learning is they make the use of flowers. Quick example. So how machine learning works, to be specific. As you see in this diagram, right? It's playing right now. So as you see in this diagram, we want to determine different types of flowers, as I've just mentioned. We have these types of flowers over here, and now we take samples of it and we feed it to the machine, to the device or the application that we're using. So here's the types of flowers that we just put it. We take record of it and we feed it to the machine or the application. And over time, the application will be able to determine what type of flower it is, as I've mentioned earlier on. So this is how machine learning works. It makes use of all the data to train machine learning models that can make prediction and inference based on the relationship they find in the data. So these are all flowers, right? And now the relationship between these flowers is that there are different types of flowers, and it's able to determine which type of flower it is, as you see in this small video. Moving on. So Tori and the others will be talking about Azure on .NET and Azure Friday. So tune in to that, because we're going to be making use of Azure a lot most of the time in the coming episodes. So tune in on .NET and Azure Friday for that session. And also tomorrow, we're having an interesting session with Data Science for Women. So as I said, this episode, we've spoken about big data and statistics. It's going to be implemented tomorrow, and it's going to be more elaborated much more. And you can tomorrow in the Women in Tech Wednesday, as they will be talking about Data Science for Women. So enough about that. So machine learning in Azure, we have automated machine learning, Azure Machine Learning Designer, data and compute management, and pipelines. So we're going to focus on all of this in the coming episodes. So automated machine learning and Azure Machine Learning Designer, these are the two tools that Azure has for those who are not interested in programming or have no programming background. So you see, Azure has everything for everybody, you know. So if you don't know any programming, or you don't have a lot of coding on your hands, you can use this automated machine learning and Azure Machine Learning Designer to make use of ML in your application or in your workspace. And then if you're one of the pros, you can use data and compute management and pipelines. So we're going to focus on all of this in the coming episodes. Moving on to the next point. Anomaly detection. So as I said, that as human beings, as us with our natural intelligence, we are limited. We cannot do everything as a machine would. And that's one of the things, is to detect mistakes, to detect faults in our systems. So, and that's where machine learning anomaly detection comes in. It's able to detect those mistakes for us. And so with the use of sensors, it's able to collect data. It's able to collect data, and throughout those data, it's able to find faults or unusual patterns within those data, and report to us what mistakes it made, what kind of mistakes there may be in the sample, as you can see. So here's an example. Here's an example of a racer who's doing his everyday thing, like the F1 racing, and F1, as we see, the F1 races. Over here, we can see that it's working fine. The first sample is working fine. The second sample is working fine. But then the third one, it goes red. How did it go red? It's because they found an unusual balance between the speed or the speed of the driver. So it's able to detect or tell the driver that something is wrong in the system. You need to get it fixed. So this is just one of the examples that is in AI, that is in under anomaly detection, you know. So we're gonna elaborate more features on this anomaly detection in our systems that we'll be creating. Now, there's nothing much to say on anomaly detection, as it's a small section. And now we move on to computer vision. Computer vision. And this is an interesting point. Computer vision. Computer vision.
Seeing AI is a Microsoft research project for people with visual impairments. The app narrates the world around you by turning the visual world into an audible experience. Point your phone's camera, select a channel, and hear a description. The app recognizes saved friends.
Jenny near top right, 3 feet away.
Describes the people around you, including their emotions.
28-year-old female wearing glasses looking happy.
It reads text out loud as it comes into view, like on an envelope.
Ken Lawrence, P.O. Box.
Or a room entrance.
Conference 2005.
Or scan and read documents like books and letters. The app will guide you and recognize the text with its formatting.
Top and left edge is not visible. Hold steady. Lease agreement. Disagreement.
When paying with cash, the app identifies currency bills.
$20.
When looking for something in your pantry or at the store, use the barcode scanner with audio cues to help you find what you want.
Campbell's tomato soup.
When available, hear additional product details.
Heated microwave bowl on height.
And even hear descriptions of images in other apps like Twitter by importing them into Seeing AI.
A close-up of Bill Gates.
Finally, explore our experimental features like scene descriptions to get a glimpse of the future.
I think it's a young girl throwing a frisbee in the park.
Experience the world around you with the Seeing AI app from Microsoft.
And there you go, folks. Another cool application or another cool service that Microsoft has to offer to the people who are disabled. You know, as I said, that it's an unfair advantage that people have when they are disabled. But with the use of that AI application that we've just saw in the video right now, people who can't talk have the ability to talk and see the world around them. Like, isn't that cool? Like, I find it really cool. And I hope that in the coming weeks, we'll make our own ones, and you can see how exciting it is when you make your own one, your own. Make use of computer vision in your application or in your everyday life. So quick, as we go through computer vision, we have image classification and object detection. So image classification classifies the images that we give it. So it classifies the objects in the picture that we have given it. So as you can see in the example, it's a picture of a taxi and it labels it a taxi, you know. So the artificial intelligence is able to detect that this picture that we've given is a taxi, is a picture of a taxi. It classifies it as a taxi. The next point, object detection. So as we feed it the picture of a day, it's able to detect the object in the picture. So the picture may be made up of various objects, and the artificial intelligence is able to detect it, detect those objects in the pictures. As we see in the example below, we have a picture of a bus, two pictures of a bus. We have a picture of a car. We have a picture of two cyclists. And all of this object detection, it involves by feeding it a lot of samples, feeding it a lot of pictures. You need to train it. You need to allow it to grow. When you do that, your results are gonna be accurate, and the capability of your machine to identify those pictures will grow. So those are the two examples of what computer vision has to offer us. Next point of what computer vision has to offer, it also offers us semantic segmentation. So it basically divides or isolates certain objects in an image. That's what basically semantic segmentation means, to isolate or detect different objects in the picture. As you see over there, we look at the pictures of the bus. The buses are red. I have the color red. The car has a color blue, and the cyclist at the color green. So if there are more cyclists in this picture, they'll have the color green. If there are more cars on this picture, it has the color blue. And if there are more buses on the picture, it'll have the color red. So it segments or divides or isolates the objects in the picture that has been given. So that's semantic segmentation. And the next one is image analysis. It's not the like object detection, but this one is different because it analyzes. It is able to tell what the picture is about. The previous one we looked was object detection. It detects objects in the picture. So if we're looking at this picture, it's going to detect a car, taxi, and a person and a dog. It's going to detect those two things. But now image analysis, it tells us more. It gives us more details about what the picture or the image is made up of. So over here it says a person with a dog on the street. So as you see, it's more specific, it's more in detail. It didn't detect those objects. It gave more details of the picture, as you can see. So that's the difference between image analysis and object detection. Most people get those points confused. So wanted to clarify that part. And another cool thing that we saw in the video was the ability to detect faces, to detect faces and human beings. So over here we can see it. I don't know what that picture doing there. Okay, pardon me for that mistake. I don't know how it got there. But this is another feature in computer vision. It's called face detection. Face detection. It's called face detection. In face detection, it's able to detect the faces on in a picture, as you can see, so for example, you know our Facebook, our Instagram, and all those that, and even the government, they're able to know who you are and what you do, you know, using this technology of face detection. So they're able to put a picture, if a picture of you comes up, and they're able to say, this is a picture of Narcisse, this is a picture of Somaleze, you know. All of this makes use of face detection. And there's even more to face detection. You're able to analyze the emotion of the person, tell the age of the person, and even tell more of the person just by looking at their face and identifying them. As you saw in the video, how the person was disabled or blind, and they're able to detect those around them, as you saw in the video. So that's another cool feature that we'll be doing in the coming episode, optical character recognition, OCR. So it's able to detect words. It's able to detect words in a picture. It's able to detect writings in a picture. That's what optical character recognition. The key word there is character recognition. It's able to detect character, the characters or the letters in a certain picture. That's what basically optical recognition is. And most of the time, you know, when you have those applications, if I'm sure most of you have those applications where you can take a picture of your receipts and it saves it as a PDF. It makes use of optical character recognition of that cognitive service. So this is just one of the cool things that we'll be doing, and I'm looking forward to it. So computer vision in Microsoft Azure. So as I said, you must get an Azure account, and Tori and Co will be talking about Azure. So don't worry about that part. So in Azure, we have four computer vision services. We have computer vision, custom vision, face, and form recognizer. So those are the four offers that cognitive services that Microsoft Azure has to offer: computer vision, custom vision, face, and form recognizer. So we'll be using all of these four tools to implement the cognitive services in our application using Microsoft Azure, as you can see. So the next part is natural language processing. This is another cool part, and I would like for you guys to see it. Late. So Melissa, how much time do we have left in the episode?
We have about 15 to 17 minutes.
Okay, cool. Just checking so we can stay on track of time.
So think about this. How often are you alive? Are you alive when the dawn of a new medium comes out? I knew that I had to be a part of VR because there are no rules for what VR should be. Starship Commander is a choose-your-own-adventure VR narrative that uses natural language processing so you can actually have a real conversation with the characters.
I'm Sergeant Sarah Pearson. I've been assigned to your wing today.
When we started making Starship Commander, we had to figure out, how do we get technology that can understand what a person's saying so that we can have these new narrative experiences? We're a science fiction game. We come up with new words. No off-the-shelf software could let us put in custom words.
Who are the Ekneans?
In our story, the bad guys are called the Ekneans. And every time we said Eknean, it would come up with really weird words that were similar to other things that you would say. And so it would get confused all the time. So we needed to make sure that we could supply our own script. We started using Microsoft Cognitive Services to power the back end of Starship Commander.
Looks cool.
Once we plugged custom speech service into Starship Commander, I had tears in my eyes when I was playing it because it's like,
oh my God.
Oh my God, this is it. This is the experience we want.
Open the hatch.
Voice print accepted. Welcome, Commander.
You can essentially put your script in there and it knows, oh, these are the ways that people are gonna talk. And these are the phrases that they're gonna say.
Cool. What's my mission?
It must be something pretty important.
And then the second thing too was the intent detection. With Lewis, you basically give it a couple statements. After you've given it a couple. Statements, you crunch it and you start typing in your own statements, and it's shockingly scary how good it picks up even stuff that you didn't put in there.
Computer, use autopilot and let's be on our way.
Autopilot engaging.
I've never seen an opportunity like this, where there's a wide open playing field, no one's written the rules yet, there's gonna be tons of amazing software out there, and I just can't wait to see what other people write.
So Melissa, did you see that? Okay, it looks like Somelese is offline. But I'm sure you saw that, and I'm sure you, the viewers, got to see what natural language processing has to offer. Basically, you can technically create your own language. You know, like I don't even know how to emphasize it or try and make it even sound cool, because by watching the video, it's already mind-blowing, and that's what it has to offer. So basically, to just define it, natural language processing is the area of AI that deals with creating software that understands written and spoken languages. So it can understand the language that we're talking about now and interpret it and make its own version or make its own language based on what we have given it. As you saw in the game is a game about space and aliens and wars and all of that. So in that we cannot use our everyday normal English. Instead, you're gonna need some new language to interact, for the users to interact and make the game more interactive. And that's what the users did, as you saw in the video. They made use of natural language processing to do that, to create a different language that we haven't even heard before or are not used to in our everyday life. And you got to see that in the video. So natural language processing helps us analyze and interpret text in documents, emails, and other sources. It interprets spoken language and synthesizes speech responses and automatically translates spoken or written phrases between language and interprets commands and determines appropriate action. This has to do with the intent base. So it's able to detect or it's able to determine the intentions of our speech. You know, I want ice cream. You know, I want this. You know, it's able to detect it. Like, I don't know. I really do not know. All I can say to you guys is that tune in for this awesome things that we'll be doing on AI Tuesdays. And this involves natural language processing. I can't define it even more enough. You saw through the video and as you read in the definition. When we look through the what Azure has to offer, it offers text analysis, translator text, speech, and most importantly, the awesome one, LUIS, Language Understanding Intelligent Servers. It says it in its name, Language Understanding Intelligent Servers. So we'll be making use of these four tools to look at the natural language and process it in order to make it into our own applications and to do more functionalities with it in our everyday life. So looking forward to that part. The next part is conversational AI. As I've mentioned, this part has to do with our bots. This just for those who are not used to bots or haven't used a bot before, I'll just quickly show you what it consists of. And I've also made a session where we created our own intelligent bots. So let's just see what it consists of. Okay. Strange. Like the internet is acting up. So let's try that again. Okay, I'll just play this one video. All of this content is being taken from the official Microsoft website, so it's not my own, as you can see. There you go. That is the use of bots in our everyday life. As you can see, all those websites that's been mentioned, the Microsoft website, the HP website, all of those websites make use of bots to communicate to their customers. And you can also use that in your everyday life. You can use the AI to do your everyday tasks. For example, if you're that person that likes to avoid people on WhatsApp, on social media, or you like to keep it to yourself, you can simply like use the WhatsApp bot to create an impersonation of you. So people may be responding to your bot while you're not available, you know. Or maybe you're a business person and you don't want to hire a lot of people. You can make use of AI using the bot to talk to your customers for you to engage to your customers for you, giving you a cost-free a less expensive budget, you know. So those are the types of things that we can use we use the bots for. So Melissa, are you still there?
Yes, I'm still here.
Well, it seems like you cut. I'm wrapping up now. I'm wrapping up. So this is conversational AI. Conversational AI simply, as it states in the name, is simply an artificial intelligence tool that allows us to create conversations, you know, between the human, between the user and the machine or the device itself. That's what conversational AI is able to do. It's like you're talking to an actual person, but you're not, and that's what we see throughout the bots. So as it says, bots can be the basis of AI solutions for customer support, reservation systems, healthcare consultation, and home automation. We'll see that one in action just now. So as we can see, conversational AI in Microsoft Azure, we have Q&A Maker, and we have Azure Bot Services. So you know those FAQ, back then we have these FAQs in a book, it's long listed, and you have to read those frequently asked questions. But now, with the use of Q&A makers, we have all those frequently asked questions on the website. You're able to ask the bot those frequently asked questions, and it will answer you as if you're talking to it, you know, as you guys have experienced it. And we also have Azure Bot Service, which we'll be looking into very soon. And as I'm ending off, in all things, in all awesomeness, in all tools that we use, we have to use it with a certain discipline and thoughts behind it, because we cannot just use something irresponsibly or without taking consideration of other factors that make part of it. And that's where responsible AI comes in. So a responsible AI, basically a fair of guidelines or that Microsoft has made, guidelines that Microsoft has made to make sure that their AI services or their AI tools are being used correctly with the correct discipline and respecting all other factors. And this includes fairness, reliability and safety, privacy and security, inclusiveness, transparency and accountability. Just to go into that, fairness, is the AI tool that I'm making, is it fair for everyone to use? Does it cater for the disabled? Does it cater for those who can talk, you know? Does it cater for those who can talk, who are not that disabled? Is it fair for them as well? Reliability and safety, is it safe to use? Is it reliable? Is it privacy and security? Is my the information that's been gathered, is it secure, and do I have a certain amount of privacy when I'm using that service? Inclusiveness. This one has to do with the organization itself. I'm not quite sure with the inclusiveness, but I will make sure to elaborate on that. Transparency. Is it open? So, for example, when do you making your AI tool? Are you being open with your users? For example, if I make a AI tool that tells the user you have to go to the dentist. So I take a picture of my teeth, right? And if my teeth is white, it's like in a perfect condition, the picture comes out as clear and the picture comes out clear. And the AI tool will take it as my teeth are fine and I don't need to go to the dentist. So now when I'm sending it to a customer, I must simply say that this So transparency, as I wanted to explain, am I being open to the users? Am I telling them the full capability and functionalities of my application? And accountability, if anything goes wrong, am I able to be accountable for it? So these are basically the six guidelines that Microsoft has developed for us to use their AI services responsibly. And I wanted to go through some of the demos. Let's see if you can go them through quickly. So Melissa, how are we doing for time?
We have 2 minutes left.
Okay, I guess one session. Okay, so this is what I'm gonna do. Make a statement. So this has to do with language understanding, the natural language processing. So I'm gonna detect this and let's see what happens. Make a statement about a lighting and Lewis will interpret and adjust the house accordingly. Let's allow. Go to energy saver mode. Okay. Go to energy saver mode. Oh, looks like it doesn't want to work. But, let's try it again. Clean. Did you guys see that? It's time to go to sleep. It turned off the light. So now the machine. So this is it's being used in smart houses. In smart houses, basically, this the type. Smart houses. So open door, open this, all of this makes use of Lewis, of natural language processing. Another example, go to energy saver mode and it turns off all of the light. I need more light to cut carrots. Let's see what happens. It switches on more lights in the kitchen, as you can see. I'm expecting guests, the last one. It switches on the lights outside. So we're going to be making our own ones in the coming episode. And that's all I have to tell you guys. So all of these are the links of where I got the content. It's not my content, but I just had help from Microsoft Learn. And that's what we're going to be emphasizing to you guys, the viewers, Microsoft Learn. That's where we get everything. And a big thank you for listening to me and having to hear what I say. I really appreciate. So Melissa, over to you.
Well, that was awesome. It was very insightful, and I actually learned a lot. So I have just one question or remark. So people should not worry about machines taking over the world, right?
Yes. Okay. For me, I would just be cautious about it, but I would say yes, they shouldn't worry about machines taking over the world.
because people have been worried about the machines taking over the world, so now they are just rejecting AI for that reason. And I've been trying to explain to them that no, man, AI is here to make our lives better. And I just directed them to the session, and they actually have to learn something about AI.
Awesome. That's really good to hear. And it's, as you said, it's making our life easy. And did you like see all those cool examples of how AI is being used? And to think of that, we're going to be making our own ones in the coming session. And I really hope they look forward to it, because I am. I don't know about them. What do you say?
Yeah, no, that's something I'm actually looking forward to. But there's just one thing or two. Some people missed the demo that you just did. So there was a suggestion in the comments that please put the links to the demos on the comment section, or you can put it in the description of the video. And okay. I want people to know that in the coming sessions, just like you said, we are going to be developing our own. And I'm actually looking forward to that, because I want to learn how to actually build an artificial intelligent app or an artificial intelligent website where it can be able to help people solve a problem in our community. Like, for an example, there was a part where you showed us that AI actually helps people who are disabled. You know, it works for them as well, and it actually makes their lives better. I think there was this one time where I saw an example of a guy who was blind, and he works for Microsoft, and he developed some glasses that have AI in which they read text on papers, in which it reads the text on paper, and it tells him what's on that paper and who's coming, what is that person carrying. And to think that you're going to show us in the coming sessions how to build something similar to that is just wonderful. And I'm very excited, and I'm pretty much sure that people are also excited as I am for the upcoming sessions.
Awesome to hear, man. Awesome to hear. And I'm also looking forward to it. As you said, it's all about helping and empowering people, as the Microsoft mission statement says, empowering every nation to do more, as you can see. And there you go, folks. So Maleze will now close up. Over to you. Thank you, everybody.
Yes. Thank you, everyone, for coming and actually listening on this session. Hopefully you guys learned a lot, because I know I did. And also, I want to thank Narcisse for taking his time to actually show us artificial intelligence is not here to ruin humankind's lives, but it's here to help us improve our lives, make it better, and help us move forward. So thanks, Narcisse, for showing us this awesome, cool stuff. I'm really, really, really psyched for the next upcoming sessions that we're going to have with you. Also, before I close off, I want to remind people that tomorrow, or at 3 to 4, if I'm not mistaken, we have Women in Tech Wednesdays, in which we will see women in data science, using data science. So I am, for an example, I am a person who has learned a lot from the ladies, and they inspire me a lot. So I want you guys to be sure to join ourselves tomorrow. And also do not miss Power Thursdays on Thursday, in which we are going to be able to show you how to build apps without writing code, and .NET Fridays. From me and Narcisse, thank you everyone for coming through, and I hope you have a good evening. Now is it wrong? Is it right? I'm still trying.
everybody else. It took a whole lot of energy to get me here. Now do I got the strength to fall and rise again? It took a whole lot of energy to get me here. Now is it wrong or is it right? I'm still trying, trying, trying.
Since I've seen you last, racking my brain to remember your laugh. I know I have no right to feel this way, because it was me that pushed you away. But it doesn't make the pain that I feel inside drift away with the changing tide.
Someday. I don't need.